A very good morning. You're watching Breakfast News with me, Smriti Rastogi. Let's begin the bulletin with the top headlines of this morning. Prime Minister Narendra Modi and Israeli Prime Minister Netanyahu to hold delegation-level talks. Both leaders stress the need to jointly combat terrorism in joint statement on Tuesday. Government closely monitoring price and supply situation of commodities following GST rollout. 175 senior central government officers to oversee implementation. Flood situation worsens in Assam. One person washed away, taking total death toll to 17. Nearly 4 lakh people affected in 13 districts. US and South Korea conduct military drill soon after North Korea's claim of launching a ballistic missile. Washington on seeks emergency meeting of UN Security Council. And Djokovic and Federer win after opponents retire with injuries. Dominic Thiem advances to round 2, so does Angelique Kerber. Prime Minister Narendra Modi arrived for a 3-day visit to Israel on Tuesday evening. In an unprecedented gesture, he was accorded a special welcome with the Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu and his entire cabinet receiving him at the airport, an honour so far bestowed only to the US President and the Pope. The two leaders will hold delegation-level talks today and discuss common challenges like terrorism and ways to boost economic ties.
Historic day. Welcome, my friend. It's wonderful to see you here in Israel.
In an extraordinary welcome, Prime Minister Narendra Modi received by Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu on arrival at the Ben-Gurion airport. Reflecting the importance that Israel is according to the first visit by an Indian Prime Minister since its establishment 70 years ago, the host nation pulled out all stops to welcome Modi, an honor reserved only for the US President and the Pope. Netanyahu's entire cabinet was also present, as were representatives of various religious orders. Speaking in Tel Aviv immediately after landing, Prime Minister Modi termed his visit as a groundbreaking journey of engagement. The Israeli Prime Minister said, even sky is not the limit in cooperation.
In our path of sustained high growth and all-round development, India counts Israel amongst its important partners. The need to rely on science, technology, innovation, and higher technical education to overcome our developmental challenges to common to both of us, alongside building a partnership for shared economic prosperity. We are also cooperating to secure our societies against common threats such as terrorism. A progressive partnership in all these areas would shape the scope of my conversation with Prime Minister, my friend Netanyahu.
Your commitment to progress. You said that when it comes to India-Israel's relations, the sky is the limit. But actually, my friend, the sky isn't the limit, because today, even our space programs are working together to achieve even greater heights. The ties between our talented, innovative peoples is natural.
Israel has set up a $40 million innovation fund as a seed for greater cooperation in the field of technology. The Prime Minister visited the Yad Vashem Memorial and honored victims of the Holocaust. He was accompanied by his Israeli counterpart. The Prime Minister also visited the Danziger Dan flower farm with Netanyahu, where they were briefed about the latest technologies being used for floriculture. A new fast-growing Israeli flower was named after Prime Minister Modi in a special gesture. Later, Prime Minister Netanyahu welcomed Prime Minister Modi to his residence in Jerusalem. During a joint news conference, both leaders talked about battling terrorism.
Yad Vashem tells us that those who believe in humanity and civilized values must come together and defeat it at all costs. As such, we must resolutely oppose the evils of terrorism, radicalism, and violence that plague our time.
But I have to say that we also face common challenges, and the first of it is to defeat the forces of terror that rampage through the world and threaten both our countries. So we must stand together in this battle, much as we work together to perfect the future.
With this visit, Prime Minister Modi lifted the curtain on a thriving military relationship between the two countries. He will hold 3 days of talks with his Israeli counterpart to advance sales and production of missiles, drones and radar systems. Prime Minister Modi will not travel to Ramallah, the seat of the Palestinian Authority, to meet with Palestinian leaders, as is common for visiting foreign dignitaries. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
And the Prime Minister's itinerary today includes meeting with Israeli President Reuven Rivlin, talks with Prime Minister Netanyahu, followed by a joint press statement is also slated. He will also visit Israeli museum with his Israeli counterpart. Later in the day, he will address the Indian community in Israel. Moving on, External Affairs Minister Sushma Swaraj on Tuesday inaugurated the two-day Delhi Dialogue on India-ASEAN ties. Addressing the 9th edition of Delhi Dialogue, Swaraj said that India was focusing on commerce, connectivity and culture as the key areas of cooperation in the future with ASEAN countries. The External Affairs Minister also called for closer cooperation among ASEAN countries in countering militancy, cyber security, anti-piracy and transnational crimes. Swaraj also invited ASEAN countries to invest in India after the rollout of the goods and services tax and said that India has enhanced its engagements in Southeast Asia under Prime Minister Narendra Modi's Act East policy. Leaders, policy makers, diplomats, business leaders and think tanks from India and ASEAN member countries are in Delhi to attend the two-day event.
The future focus areas of cooperation between ASEAN member states and India can thus be described in terms of three C's: commerce, connectivity and culture. This triumvirate, of course, rests on the platform of stability and security. We remain committed with ASEAN to enhance our maritime cooperation to realize the full potential of our ocean economy. We will continue to step up cooperation in countering terrorism, cyber security, anti-piracy and other transnational crimes.
As the India-China standoff continues over the border issues in Sikkim, Beijing has launched a scathing attack on India with its remarks. On Tuesday, China ruled out a compromise in the military standoff and has put the onus on New Delhi to resolve the grave situation. In unusually blunt remarks, China's ambassador to India has said that the ball is in India's court. He said that Chinese government is very clear that it wants peaceful resolution of the current situation, for which the withdrawal of Indian troops from the area is a precondition. India and China have been engaged in a standoff in the Dokalam area near the Bhutan Tri-Junction for past 19 days after a Chinese army's construction party came to build a road. Dokala is the Indian name for the region which Bhutan recognizes as Dokalam, while China claims it as the part of Donglang region. Standoff between the China and Indian troops led to the cancellation of Kailash Mansarovar Yatra through Nathula in Sikkim.
इस मध्य क्षेत्र की सीमा को हमेशा माना गया कि सेटल्ड बॉर्डर रहा है दोनों देशों के बीच पर आज चाइना उसको विवादित बनाने का प्रयास कर रहा है यह दुर्भाग्यपूर्ण है और विवाद का आधार के रूप में जो 1892 का चाइना ब्रिटिश एग्रीमेंट की बात चाइना कर रहा है यह भी आश्चर्य की बात है क्योंकि 1914 का मैकमहन लाइन को भी हमेशा चाइना कहता रहा कि यह तो साम्राज्यवादी रेखा है
दिस एरिया बिलोंग्स टू भूटान एंड भूटान हैज ऑलरेडी प्रोटेस्टेड टू चाइना दैट दे आर इनग्रेसिंग इनटू देयर टेरिटरी एंड बिल्डिंग रोड्स India is sensitive because this area is strategically very important. Anybody dominating the Dolan Plateau can interfere with our communication with all the northeastern states. So India has a very strong reason, apart from our very special relation with Bhutan.
On to the situation in Darjeeling, where the Gorkha Janmukti Morcha has sought a CBI probe in the death of the three supporters. In a letter to the Home Ministry, the Morcha sought a probe by the central agency into the death place due to the police firing on the June 17th. It also termed the recent violent incidents as unprecedented violation of human rights by the West Bengal police. Rallies were organized in various parts of the Darjeeling Hills in support of its demands for the separate Gorkha land. The Gorkha Janmukti Yuva Morcha has announced that it will go on a hunger strike in Delhi and Darjeeling. Meanwhile, the GJM chief, Bimal Gurung, once again requested all political parties to discuss the demand on the separate state. He has, however, said that the shutdown will continue.
कि हम लोग का वन पॉइंट एजेंडा है गोरखलैंड और हम लोग सिर्फ गोरखलैंड के लिए अभी आगे जाके लड़ाई लड़ रहा हूँ और मैं सभी घटक दल सभी पार्टियों को मैं रिक्वेस्ट करना चाहता हूँ और आदर संस्कार के तरफ से मैं उसको अपील भी करना चाहता हूँ कि सभी वन पॉइंट एजेंडा गोरखलैंड के लिए आगे आके लड़ना चाहिए.
The government is closely monitoring price and supply situation of commodities following the implementation of GST. Addressing the media on Tuesday, Revenue Secretary Hasmukh Adia said that the implementation of new tax reform has been smooth so far. Adia added that the government is closely monitoring prices and supplies of goods. He also said that about 175 of the central government will be given the responsibility of 4 to 5 districts to monitor the situation.
इस व्यवस्था के तहत अगर कुछ भी ऐसा देश में हो रहा है तो तुरंत हमको पता लगना चाहिए. अभी तक के जो खबर आए उसमें एक भी ऐसा इंसिडेंट नहीं हमें मालूम हुआ है कि जिसमें कोई प्रॉब्लम हुआ हो. वो देखते हुए ये लग रहा है कि करीब सुचारू रूप से अच्छी तरह से जीएसटी की स्वीकृति देश में हो गई है.
The Supreme Court has granted the Centre and the Reserve Bank of India 2 weeks to consider the option of allowing people to deposit their demonetized notes. A bench comprising Chief Justice J.S. Kheher and Justice D.Y. Chandrachud asked Solicitor General and Centre's representative Ranjit Kumar to take instructions on the issue. The bench was hearing a batch of petitions and was of the opinion that people who have a compelling reasons for not depositing the old 500 and 1000 rupees notes should be allowed to do so. The Solicitor General then sought time to seek instructions for granting an opportunity to persons to deposit their money on a case-by-case basis. Prime Minister Narendra Modi had on November 8th last year announced that 500 and 1000 currency notes would no longer be legal tender. People were given time until March 31st to deposit the money at RBI branches after complying with certain formalities. NDA's presidential nominee Ram Nath Kovind and his rival Meera Kumar continue to seek support for their candidature from across the country for the 17th July polls. While Kumar will visit Northeast today, Kovind will be in Bengaluru. During her day-long visit, Kumar would meet legislators of the region in the 2 separate meetings in Shillong and Guwahati. The former Lok Sabha Speaker will also interact with MLAs and MPs of the Congress Party of Assam, Mizoram, Arunachal Pradesh, Manipur and Sikkim. Union Ministers Thavarchand Gehlot, Anand Kumar and BJP General Secretary Saroj Pandey will accompany Kovind during his meetings with the lawmakers in Karnataka. After their nominations last month, Kumar and Kovind have been visiting various states as a part of their campaign for the top constitutional post. The Election Commission on Tuesday issued a notification for the upcoming vice presidential election. The election for the post of vice president is scheduled to be held on August 5th. The last date for filing nominations is July 18th, while the last date for withdrawal of candidature is 21st of July. Neither the ruling NDA nor the opposition has so far announced their respective candidates for the post. The term of Vice President Mohammad Hamid Ansari, who held the post for two consecutive terms, is coming to an end on August 10th. For the vice presidential election, a candidate needs 20 proposers and 20 seconders who should be the members of the parliament.
The Election Commission has sounded the bugle for the elections to the post of Vice President of India. We have with us the Assistant Returning Officer for these elections and a senior official in the Rajya Sabha Secretariat, Mr. Mukul Pandey. Pandeyji, the entire schedule is out, the notification is out today, and it's being said that the elections, if necessary, will take place on 5th. How will the entire process work for this, almost a month?
Yeah, as you know, the notification has been issued today, and with this, the election process has started. The nomination papers can be filed up to 3 p.m. on 18th of July, and thereafter on 19th, in the morning at 11 o'clock, the scrutiny of the nomination papers will take place, and those whose nomination papers, which are found valid in the after the scrutiny, those candidates, they can withdraw their names from the fray till 21st of July by 3 p.m. And if there are more than one candidate left after that, then there will be election. And that election will take place on 5th of August. The polling time will be from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. And immediately thereafter, I mean, about 1 hour or so, the counting will start. And hopefully in an hour's time, the result will be declared.
Okay, it's going to be a quick affair, the same day voting, same day polling.
Because the Electoral College consists only of
members of parliament from Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. So essentially a lot of preparation must have been done. Are you guys all well set to ensure that everything is done as per the instructions of the Election Commission and on time?
Yeah, our people are quite experienced. They have conducted these president and vice presidential elections time and number of times. So they are well prepared, they are well equipped. We have taken all the measures, including the security, and the election process will go as per the schedule.
Okay, thank you so much. So this was the Assistant Returning Officer for the Vice Presidential Elections, Mr. Mukul Pandey. Seems the entire setup is all ready and raring to go to ensure that it is once again a free and fair election for the post of Vice President of India. With camera person Sarosh, this is Vishal Dhiya, Rajya Sabha TV, Delhi.
Achal Kumar Jyoti on Tuesday was appointed the next Chief Election Commissioner. He will be succeeding the incumbent Naseem Zaidi. 64-year-old Jyoti was the Chief Secretary of Gujarat when Prime Minister Narendra Modi was the Chief Minister. According to the notification issued by the Law Ministry, he will assume office on July 6th. Zaidi will demit office on today. Jyoti, a 1975 batch Indian Administrative Service officer, had joined the three-member poll panel as an election commissioner on May 8, 2015 and would be in office till January 17th next year. A CEC or an EC can have a tenure of 6 years or hold office till the age of 65 years, whichever is earlier. Jyoti will be the 21st CEC. He has served as the Gujarat Vigilance Commissioner and worked in various capacities in the state. And with that, we'll slip into a very short break. More news and updates on the other side. Stay with us.
The recent launch of the GST, was it right on the part of Congress to boycott the event?
This attempt to equate the launch of GST with the independence of India, that's what we were opposed. You know, I called GST grand self-promotional tamasha.
Nitish Kumar has consistently been saying that it is Congress which is solely responsible for the current mess in which the opposition is.
Media also, you know, hypes up statements and they try to read between the lines.
A lot has been written about the fact that about the high command culture which exists within the Congress party. And
you think the high command culture doesn't exist in the BJP?
Watch To The Point with senior Congress leader Jairam Ramesh only on Rajya Sabha television.
Welcome back. Situation in Northeast worsens after one more person dies in Assam floods and a rescue chopper goes missing from Arunachal Pradesh. The flood situation in Assam deteriorated, with one more person being washed away by the gushing waters and over 3.8 lakh people left affected in 13 districts of the state. With this, the total number of deaths in the year's flood-related incidents has gone up to 17, including 7 in Guwahati. Also, an IAF chopper, which was on a flood victim rescue mission with three crew members on board, went missing near Sagali in Papumpare district of Arunachal Pradesh. The chopper was evacuating people stranded at Sagali due to landslides triggered by rains. Chief Minister Prema Khandu is monitoring the situation. Directives have been issued by the administration and the police to extend all possible help in the search and rescue operation. The villagers have also asked to help the administration in locating the missing chopper. North Korea once again provoked the international community as it claimed to have successfully tested its first intercontinental ballistic missile on Tuesday. South Korea, US and Japan have strongly condemned the launch, while China called for restraint and peaceful solution to the Korean Peninsula problem. US and South Korea conducted a military drill soon after the launch. North Korea on Tuesday claimed it successfully test-fired its first long-range intercontinental missile that it says can reach anywhere in the world. Called the Hwangsong-14 on the state television, the missile reached a height above 2,500 kilometers and flew 578 miles before landing in the sea between North Korea and Japan. 동기의 전략적 결단에 따라 조선민주주의인민공화국 국방과학원 과학자 기술자들은 새로 연구 개발한 대륙간 탄도로켓 화성 14형 시험 발사를 성공적으로 진행하였다. South Korea strongly condemned what it called an irresponsible provocation, saying it is maintaining military readiness for a possible further provocation by North Korea.
지난 5월 14일 발사한 탄도 미사일보다 사거리가 향상된 것으로 평가되나 북한의 주장처럼 소위 대륙간 탄도 미사일의 능력을 갖췄는지 여부에 대해서는
Japan also strongly protested the latest launch, calling it a clear violation of UN resolutions, while China, that is Pyongyang's only ally in the region, urged restraint after the launch and opposed the repeated violations of the UN Security Council resolutions.
北朝鮮が またもや 弾道ミサイルの発射を強行しました。 度重なる国際社会の警告を無視するものであります。
Russia and China, meanwhile, together called on the North Korea, South Korea and the United States to sign up a Chinese de-escalation plan designed to defuse tensions around Pyongyang's missile program. The plan would see North Korea suspend its ballistic missile program and the United States and South Korea simultaneously ending large-scale missile exercises.
И китайских идеях параллельного замораживания ракетно-ядерной деятельности КНДР и крупномасштабных военных учений Соединенных Штатов Америки и Республики Корея.
If confirmed, the intercontinental ballistic missile could potentially have the range to reach the US mainland. In a Twitter outburst, US President Donald Trump urged North Korea's neighbor China to end this nonsense once and for all. The United Nations has imposed multiple sets of sanctions on Pyongyang over its weapons program. North Korea, in its defense, says it needs nuclear arms to defend itself against the threat of invasion. Bureau report, Sabha TV. On to some more international developments, foreign ministers of Egypt, Saudi Arabia, Bahrain and UAE will meet in Cairo today to discuss whether to end the crisis or impose further sanctions on Qatar. The four countries received the Qatari response via Kuwait before the end of the additional deadline on Tuesday. Qatar has called the list of demands unrealistic and not actionable. UAE on Tuesday urged Qatar to stop its alleged funding of terrorism. UAE foreign minister said that the decision of the Saudi-led quarters to boycott Qatar matured after years of patience. Qatar, meanwhile, announced plans to increase natural gas production by 30% over the next several years. The decision comes on the back of increased pressure from its neighbors in a diplomatic crisis. And let's take a look at other developments from across the world in World Wrap. The death toll rose to 10 in a garment factory blast in Bangladesh. The blast happened as the factory was being readied to resume operations following a 10-day shutdown for the Eid holiday. The explosion at the boiler also damaged a nearby three-story factory building. The search was still on for more victims. At least 56 people were killed and several others were missing as heavy rains left a trail of destruction in 11 Chinese provinces. 27,000 houses collapsed while 37,000 others were damaged in floods. According to the Ministry of Civil Affairs, around 10 million people have been affected. The water in major rivers and lakes in the southern province of Hunan have surged to alarming levels. Relief and rescue operation is underway. US-backed Syrian forces have breached the wall around Raqqa's old city. The move marks a major advance within a week. Old battle to drive Islamic State militants out of their self-declared capital. According to the Britain-based Syrian Observatory for Human Rights, the breaching of the wall was the most important development in the battle for Raqqa. And on to the sports news. High on confidence after three wins on the trot, India would look to continue their unbeaten streak and take another step towards a semi-final berth when they face Sri Lanka in the ICC Women's World Cup today. The India vs Sri Lanka Women's World Cup match will be played at the county ground in Derby. The match will start at 3 in the afternoon according to the Indian time. Indian women cricket team fixed their third successive victory against Pakistan by 95 runs on Sunday. On to Wimbledon, where women's world number one Anjali Kerber won her first round match, while Novak Djokovic and Roger Federer both won their games due to the retirements of their respective opponents. Dominic Thiem also advanced to the second round. Seven times champion Roger Federer reached the second round of Wimbledon on Tuesday after his opponent Alexander Dolgopolov pulled out 6-3, 3-0 down in the second set, whereas Djokovic, a three-time Wimbledon champion, had taken the first set 6-3 before Klizan called the trainer on the court to treat a leg injury. Also, Dominic Thiem beat Wessek 6-4, 6-4, 6-3 in the first round. And top seed Anjali Kerber recorded a 6-4, 6-4 victory over American qualifier Americana Irina Falcone after an hour and 27 minutes of play on center court. Women's third seed Karolina Pliskova eased past Russian Evgenia Rodina 6-1, 6-4. And that's all we have for you in this edition of Breakfast News. Keep watching Rajya Sabha Television.